Stories. ways to bring them into everybody's life and to help them to get the attention they need to get. But she also gives something services as writer, editor, translator, and coach, consultant, and professional storyteller via www.gingerbreadwords.net. So, yeah, that is Gina, but you can visit her and you will understand how great her work is. I hope it's okay for just start with the disclaimer, and as I said, it's also a trigger warning. Disclaimer. Attention, and a little spoiler. In this book, you will encounter characters that suffer. You will find prose and poetry about topics like pain, loss, identity crisis, rape, depression, burnout, disorders, suicide, loneliness, rage, and other intense emotions and life-influencing events. If you suffer from serve mental health issues or have gone through a tough time recently, easily affected by the events taking place in fictional stories, I urge you to be careful. I am not a psychologist, therapist, or in any other way authorized or competent in those fields to tell you what's recommendable for you and what's not. If you are unsure whether this book might make your issues exacerbate or not, I recommend letting someone else read it and asking them for their opinion. Also, I'd recommend to stop reading immediately when it's increasing your issues and goes beyond being emotionally moved by the stories. If you have been affected by any of the topics discussed in this book, please contact www.befrienders.org. You may find the support you're looking for from national websites online. So, yeah, you need to be careful because I don't want you to feel bad. I just want to show you that you aren't alone. I just want to read this book because it might help you to see it from a different side. I just wanted to read you a short story and a poem of this book because I don't want to read the whole book. So you can just buy it. It's available on Amazon. I will link everything down below in the comments. Decided to read you the following short story because it was a super touching story for me, and yeah, I think it could be also for you. So it's called One Night in February. Safety reasons, and safety gives freedom for creativity. So I was walking down the street, passing the houses that I pass nearly every day, when driving the car, passing the street lights. At the end of the road, I turned left and passed houses which I normally don't pass that often. Passed one of the big paddocks, past the farm that sells firewood and Christmas trees during Advent. Here I made a halt and wondered whether I should walk on or turn around and go back, because the dead end before me attracted me somehow, and because I realized that I had never walked it until the end, I decided to follow this feeling and to walk the path between the riding stable and the paddocks. While I was walking and dwelling on thoughts, the typical sound of horses came into my nose. I turned my head to the right and let my gaze wander over the paddocks, and behind them I saw the houses that I pass every morning on the bus. How peacefully they were lying there, those houses with their warm lights. After having passed the extensive buildings of the riding stable, my gaze fell upon an old wall and trees covering a house that stood behind. Shortly afterwards, I came across the illuminated driveway to that house, and that was exactly the moment when I stopped and wondered, isn't that what everybody is wishing for? A house in a countryside-like era, but still not too far away from the city. A little house in an era that resembles the landscape in Midsummer Murders. And when you lift your eyes a bit, you can see the distant city lights. Wouldn't this be the perfect location to live in? Finding contemplation in your little house, lying quietly beside the calmness in the purest form, or when you feel the need to get in touch with people, feel that hectic life in a city where you sometimes seem to be anonymous and sometimes just too well known by the people you met. You just walk for a few minutes, take the next bus, and there you are in that beautiful, dirty, loud, pretty, familiar city. Mixed audiences, mixed jobs, mixed feelings, and mixed thoughts. this air so much. How come that there are paths directly beside me and still I've never walked them before? How can I bless all this beauty and tranquility without even really perceiving it? The hectic nature of the city told me so much that I had become unaware of what was going on next right to me. Does it really matter? Now I am here, and this moment is just here to be enjoyed. The air is just here to be inhaled, and this feeling is just here to help me find contemplation and get my restless mind sorted again. I walked further on, letting my gaze wander around the paddocks, the green fields, the quiet houses with their illuminated windows, until I finally came to the end of the dead end. Here I turned around and stood for a while, letting all the odors, the fresh breeze, the picture of the sky with stars, and everything that I perceived in that moment enter my soul. Then I slowly made my way back the road that had led me to the dead end, past the illuminated driveway from the house that lies behind an old wall and trees, past the riding stable, past the farm that sells firewood, past the paddocks. After thinking about taking a different way back home, I decided to walk back on my own trail, a bit like a dog. Well, it wasn't a real decision, but I just did what my inner feelings told me. So I walked past the houses that I normally don't pass that often, looking around the green meadows and the houses in the small street with parked cars on it. As I walked further on, I watched my own feet making one step after the other. I examined the pavement as I walked on it further and further on. Shortly before the junction where I had turned left before, my look fell upon a small ball lying on the pavement. A small pink and green ball. As I lifted my head again, after having stared at the ball for minutes, my eyes were filled with tears. And all of a sudden, a thought entered my mind. You are not dead. How could you be dead when I still carry you with me in my heart? In my every step I take, in every decision I make, in everything I do, in everything I am. You are not dead. How could you be? How could somebody dare to tell me you are dead when I feel you with me every day? When I can see you in my dreams? When I'm talking to you right now? How could you be dead then? This is ridiculous. You are not dead. How could anybody ever tell that somebody is dead? Nobody is ever really dead as long as there are people remembering this person. As long as there are memories, as long as there are photographs, as long as there are text, diary entries, poems, stories, little notes, and emotion that trace back their existence, this person can't be dead. As long as there are memories shared at a table, as long as there are conversation about that passed away person, as long as the texts are read and the photographs are viewed, as long as the memorizing heart is beating and the missing tears are flooding, you can't be dead. Isn't that an amazing idea? How about building a house and making a room for everyone you love, designed with all the things this person is attached to? A room from mother, filled with books and green plants, with gentle music and everything she loves. But wait, no, just one room for one person wouldn't really fit to the existence of that person. This room has to be linked to another room, to the room of somebody this first person is attached to. And how you build this house doesn't matter. Whether it is done in text or photographs, in paint, As long as there are traces of your existence, you can't be dead. Shakespeare isn't dead. Wilde isn't dead. Wolfe and Austen are not dead because their works are still read. Their biographies are still discussed. Their works are still analyzed and people talk about them, have discussions, fall in love with them and become fans. How can Shakespeare, Wilde and Wolfe be dead when a trace of their existence is still so present and vivid today? Isn't that what every author is wishing for? Immortality. So that is the first story. And yeah, I love, I love the way she wrote it. So this is a very touching story, Gina. Well done. And now I just wanted to read you a short poem. And the rest is for you. Existence. Behind all those pretty polished Chinese squares, there are lives of people dead to dare, to life beyond perfect imaginary that's truly there to be. This is so lovely. And this book is full of these stories, full of these thoughts. Full of poems, and it is also connected with life. It's really amazing. So if you want to read this book, as I said, it's available on Amazon. It's not that expensive. And as already mentioned, a percentage of the income will be donated to local health institutions. So you would do a very good thing for anybody who needs help. So guys, I guess that was our video for today. I'm so glad that you joined to this reading session and to my cozy place. And I really hope that we will see us in some of the next videos. And as I said, if you need some help, to tell anybody, okay? Thank you so much for watching, my loves. And thank you again, Gina, that you allowed me to give this little review, some kind of review of your book. And thank you also so much for the very nice conversations we had so far. And I hope we will all stay connected. So guys, get right now to Gina Laventura's page and yeah, just tell us, what do you think about the stories in the books? Do you like it? Just let us know, okay? Thank you so far. Have a great, great night. Sleep well. And we will see us pretty soon.